In the end of the 1970s, Tom Kirkwood has proposed a theory that can now be considered the standard theory of aging. It is generally called the disposable soma theory of aging. In a nutshell, its content is that aging is the necessary consequence of an allocation of resources that must give a priority to the preservation of germline cells over somatic cells. This theory is now shaping a lot of research programs in biogerontology, although its content and the perspective it provides are sometimes overwhelmed by the wealth of data experimental research has gathered since the formulation of the disposable soma theory. Let's see what this theory says. The starting point of the disposable soma theory was stated in a 1977 paper. It is that resources are not in infinite quantities in an organism and must therefore be allocated to growth, maintenance and repair, reproduction, storage and defense. The disposable soma theory asserts that in very general circumstances, the optimal level of investment in maintenance will be less than what would be required for the body to maintain its state indefinitely. Hence, the necessity of aging, which necessarily follows from imperfect maintenance. Note that this view does not stem from an evolutionary perspective. The second part of the theory, developed in 1979, is that the level of the trade-off is fixed by optimal fitness. Growth and reproduction are a priority over maintenance and repair, but maintenance and repair are, to a point, necessary to ensure growth and reproduction. Kirkwood writes, "We have already noted for most species longevity is determined more by the rate of accidental mortality than by any intrinsic aging. There is, therefore, no point in an organism investing more resources in somatic maintenance than is necessary for it to last sufficiently long in adequate reproductive condition to realize its normal expectation of life. In particular, by reducing control over the accuracy of somatic macromolecular synthesis to the minimum viable level, an organism could either reduce its energy needs or accelerate its reproduction, or both. The penalty for this saving would be a progressive increase through life in the proportion of cells committed to error catastrophe, leading ultimately to a fatal breakdown of homeostasis, but this would occur sufficiently late and affect sufficiently few individuals not to detract from the selective benefit of the strategy." This second part of the theory has led to general intuitive predictions that seem realized. First, species threatened by predation should tend to invest more in growth and reproduction and less in repair and maintenance. They should reach sexual maturity quickly and age quickly. This is indeed the general observation. Note that this prediction by the disposable soma theory was already made by Medawar's theory or by Williams. Second, there should be a primary pacemaker system that controls the overall rate of aging and permits relatively rapid evolutionary change in longevity. This pacemaker system is described in abstract terms as mechanisms of intracellular error regulation that somehow check the conformity of macromolecules, genes or proteins. This prediction is original as compared to the classic evolutionary framework. It successfully linked the then future development in the molecular biology of aging to evolutionary theory. It also explains where the wearing off of parts of an organism came from. That is, that it is necessary in some organisms and where its necessity comes from. It eventually made a new claim of rapid evolutionary change in longevity, which is strikingly different from what the classic evolutionary framework predicted. This prediction was very much in line with the discovery since the 1990s of a series of genes of aging. See the video on genes of aging. Here is the fundamental curve that summarizes the main mechanism according to Kirkwood. This curve represents the level of integrity in an organism of a replicated macromolecule at generation T plus 1 as a function of the integrity of the same type of macromolecule at generation T. Due to stochastic events, it may happen at any point in time that molecular integrity in generation T is more or less degraded. The dashed line represents a constant level of integrity across generations of macromolecules. If an organism falls below this line, it means that it cannot repair, that errors leads to even more errors, which is often described as a catastrophic behavior. On the contrary, if the organism moves above the line, it can improve the integrity of macromolecules from one generation to the other. Aging can be understood as a series of generations that progressively lose accuracy in replication due to insufficient repair mechanisms. Now, if a generation of macromolecules is very degraded, the level of resources to repair it is very high. If it is not very degraded, the level of resource to repair the generation of macromolecules is lower. How should organisms invest in repair? Kirkwood says they should just invest enough in repair to be able to ensure or optimize reproduction. This investment should represent a sufficient margin of safety. See, there are two S-shaped curves on the figure. The one on the left represents a pattern of investment in repair that ensures a bigger margin of safety than the one on the right, but also a bigger investment. Indeed, this first pattern can tackle a wider range of degradation without falling into the catastrophic line of events, but it is costly. The second pattern is optimized in that it leaves resources free for other purposes like growth and reproduction. Does this theory provide a useful framework for aging research? Kirkwood writes, "The importance of a strong, coherent theoretical framework for aging research is that it provides a means of integrating a highly disparate set of experimental models and observations. Theory must, however, be continually challenged, and we now consider some of the apparent exceptions that test the rules. Although it is often presented as an alternative to the other evolutionary theories of aging, it is easy to see that it rather presupposes and completes them. For instance, it obviously presupposes Medawar's claim that the existence of extrinsic causes of death and the fact that selection pressure decreases with time explain the accumulation of late deleterious traits. But it also shows an important limitation to Williams' antagonistic pleiotropy theory. Indeed, Williams says that a gene may have two effects, one early, favorable effect, that is, selected, and one late, deleterious, that cannot be eliminated, depending on the organismal environment. But, says Kirkwood, the changing organismal environment is precisely what is to be explained, that is, aging itself. The disposable soma theory has played an important role in preventing frontal clash between evolutionary theories and molecular theories of aging. By the end of the 1990s, the investigation for and discovery of aging genes had become a problem for the peaceful coexistence of the fields of evolutionary and molecular biology of aging. These two approaches were even initially presented as rival hypotheses on aging, with test cases. Some evolutionary biologists remain convinced that physiologists just don't understand the basic tenets of the evolutionary framework when they investigate a so-called genetic program for aging, or that they hold a medical rather than a biological view of aging. On the other hand, some biogerontologists went so far as to claim that the evolutionary framework has become, in its canonical form, a hindrance to the development of the field. However, a consensual and synthetic view is now emerging. The gene regulation theory of aging does not insist on the existence of a program of aging, but instead suggests that genes regulate the rate of aging and explain its variability. Most of the regulatory pathways involved in this process are related to metabolism between different programmed regimens of cell activity, glucose consumption, autophagy, etc. Aging can thus be seen as a byproduct of evolution, the modulation of which directly results from natural selection. In some ecological niches, a lower rate of aging results in fitter organisms. Some lifetime history traits display forms of plasticity that fully qualify as a modulation of aging. The main mechanism involved in the modulation is generally metabolic, very much in line with Kirkwood's disposable soma theory. However, some objections can be made. First, it is unclear that all and only organisms with a germline soma distinction age, as the theory predicts. This prediction has not been refuted, but is still in discussion. Some unicellular organisms age. Across the tree of life, almost any pattern of senescence can be found. The existence of a germline has just been established in Orbicella faveolata, a coral that is generally considered as non-senescent, although this has consistently been questioned by Kirkwood himself. Ctenophores, flatworms, sponges are taxa that contain an infinite number of animals that are still mostly unknown. Second, the existence of a trade-off between growth, reproduction, and maintenance longevity involves that all patterns of mortality, fertility are possible, which is actually the case. However, this prediction is empty when it comes to specific patterns of given species. It does not say what is impossible, apart from using more resources than available. It can make predictions only for individuals in species or for different patterns equally possible in the same species, when these patterns exist. In the end, although the disposable soma theory has played an important historical role and is still widely cited as a common framework, many specialists in cellular and molecular biology feel that it is too broad and too loose to really help them in their research. Although it would be exaggerated to claim that it is useless, it is unquestionable that it focuses the debates on a small set of questions. For instance, is it compatible to be senescent and have no germline soma distinction, or to be non-senescent and have one? Biogerontology has raised many more questions that the disposable soma theory does not clearly answer or for which it does not provide guidance.